Our goal in these three videos is to tackle entropy, to make some sense out of disorder. Why gases diffuse, why heat flows from hot to cold, why nature makes some processes spontaneous, and why sometimes we can add work to a system in order to increase the order. Our job is to make sense out of disorder with these two equations, especially this one, Clausius's equation. That's what we're going to do in this video, using the results from part one, which were these equations. And these ideal gas processes, and these equations too. The asterisk means adiabatic only, delta Q equals zero. So again, some processes like the pendulum or phase changes are reversible and other processes are not. Carnot's challenge was to design an ideal, reversible engine. It may not look like much, but the challenge for this engine is to find out what a reversible process means for entropy, for disorder. The Carnot engine can expand or contract, and it can do this either adiabatically with a temperature change or isothermally, adding or losing heat. And you can see this on a pressure volume graph. Two of the processes are isothermal, two are adiabatic. Again, this is reversible, totally different from an internal combustion engine. In that case, no way to run it backwards and get your gasoline back. Start here. Low pressure, large volume, low temperature, and an isothermal compression. Not much of an engine so far. Not only are we putting in work to compress the gas, we're also expelling heat. Next, an adiabatic compression, an even smaller volume, but a new, higher temperature. Then, an isothermal expansion. Heat was added, so we're still at the same higher temperature. We've got high thermal energy at this point. Let's use it. Adiabatic expansion. Bam, back to low temperature. And the beginning. So to review, heat was added to the system during this stage and removed over here. The area inside the curve is equal to the total work put out by the engine. It's a heat engine. The flow of heat from hot to cold is made to do work. Almost like flowing water can turn a water wheel and do work. But that was going clockwise. Clausius wanted, remember, a reversible engine. So what happens now? Heat is still added and still removed, but this time work is put into the system in order to move the heat from the cold to the hot. It's a heat pump, like a water pump can pump water out of your flooded basement. Awesome, except for the flooded basement. But what about entropy? Now just a minute. First, we proved something in part one that we can use here. Division. It's a thing. Ratios. Tasty. Remember that we only have two temperatures to worry about, but four different volumes. So cross multiplication, also still a thing. And this is the result of all that work from part one, and it is a bit of a letdown. It's not fancy like being raised to the gamma minus one power, but here is something we can use, and it's non-obvious. Okay, so what about entropy? We've made a little bit of progress thinking adiabatic. Now let's think isothermal, and we've seen this equation before. Notice how the negative results in switching the numerator and the denominator inside the natural logarithm. With this, we can find heat. Whether it's being put in or taken out, we can find heat. And remember that the other two processes are adiabatic. No heat there. This equation works for Q for either the engine or the pump. Energy works out great, but there's got to be something more. There's got to be something that works out that balances out not just energy. QH is greater than QC, but we want to run this system forward and backward and forward and backward. And the point here is something else has to be conserved. We're looking at reversible reactions. That means looking at energy isn't enough. Conservation of energy works out for the pendulum and for the fire, but one is reversible and the other increases disorder in a way that cannot be reversed. Some chemical reactions are reversible, not this one. So even though, to say it a third time, even though QH is bigger than QC, something must be taken out and put back in equal amounts. And the good thing is we have this equation. But something isn't perfect. V2 smaller than V1, so the denominator here is negative. Oh, no, that fixes it. I told you, we're not arguing about negatives here. We're talking about amounts of heat added or removed. Negative, get out of the way. Anyway, it's a good thing we have that ratio because we certainly spent enough time finding it. But was it worth it? Yes, because we're done. Something is conserved for both the high temp and low temp isothermal processes. We call that entropy. There was no change in heat during the other two stages of the Carnot cycle. No change in entropy? Is that allowed? Well, let's take a closer look at this to find out just how awesome the Carnot cycle is, just how awesome Clausius's equation is with this new graph. Temperature versus energy. Stage 1. Isothermal compression. Temperature is constant. Entropy decreases. Is that allowed? Well, yeah. Yes, you are putting work into the system. Also, those particles are getting crammed into a smaller volume. Less room to run around. Sounds like less disorder to me. Or look at the equation. Delta Q here is negative, so entropy decreases. Stage 2. Adiabatic compression. Increased temperature, but constant entropy. Does that make sense? Yes. The volume's even smaller now, so they're going faster, but inside an even smaller room. Next, isothermal expansion. Heat is added. Volume increases. Entropy increases. Also, looking at the equation, T is higher, so that means if the entropy is balanced, that QH must be bigger, which is what we already knew. Could. Final stage, adiabatic expansion. The gas has more room to run around, but is running slower at a lower temperature. Entropy does not change. Done! That's Clausius. Nice. But what about the second one? What does that mean? And can it play nice with the equation that we just found? Find out in part 3.